these girls and women, they are amazing. And I think we need to extend our solidarity. It's very important that we follow what's happening in Iran, also what's happening in Afghanistan, in different parts of the world where women have been denied their most basic human rights, universal human rights. I really am in awe of their courage. As you mentioned, after the killing of Mahsa Amini, a Kurdish young woman, Jina Mahsa Amini, there have been lots of people on the streets, even though it's incredibly dangerous. And this is the young generation. That's the thing, you know. A huge part of Iranian population is so young, under the age of 30. This is a completely new generation. They don't want that kind of authoritarianism. They don't want that kind of oppression. And they feel connected with the rest of the world. I'm a big believer in having a dose of pessimism and a dose of optimism together. Because too much pessimism, of course, weighs us down, then we lose hope. But too much optimism, I don't like that either, because then, you know, why bother? Things will sort themselves out. So maybe a half and half, a conscious optimism and the creative pessimism is, I think, what we need most right now. And of course, it has become one of the most cited quotes from Gramsci in the last years. How interesting is that, Gramsci's famous saying about the pessimism of the intellect and the optimism of the will, of the heart, is, I think, very much relevant for our times.
Just going back for a minute to your situation that you described, and I know you very because of your great desire to show solidarity with others, you quickly deflected that away from yourself. But I mean, I can't imagine what it must have been like to suddenly, from you know, being a very well-known author in your home country, very loved and selling enormous quantities of books. To have just given birth to your first child and to become a kind of hate figure. I mean, how on earth do you, how did you find the resilience to overcome what I'm certain must have been an extraordinarily traumatic period in your life?
You know, sometimes I think being a novelist in Turkey is a bit like being kissed on one cheek while being slapped on the other cheek. And you experience this simultaneously. So it's a very strange experience in the sense that when you connect with the people, and to me this is very important, people who love books, people who love literature, there's something very genuine and deep and loving there. In Turkey, a book is not a personal item. And many of my friends who, you know, Indian authors, Pakistani authors, they're telling me it's exactly the same for them too, in the sense that in Turkey, if a reader likes a book, they don't just put it back on the shelf, they pass it on. So they share that novel with their best friend, and the best friend gives it to their mother, and the mother sends it to their neighbor. So the same copy can be read by 5 to 6 people on average. That kind of word of mouth, that kind of sharing of books is so beautiful. It's so heartwarming, and I can never lose sight of that. But on the other hand, being a novelist in Turkey feels like being slapped on the other cheek constantly because, as I mentioned earlier, whatever you say offends the authorities in a country where there's no proper freedom of speech. In addition to that, I will add that for women, it's much harder. You know, the literary world at first glance looks egalitarian, but it is not. It is a very sexist environment. And as I'm getting older, I realize more and more that it will be much harder for younger women. So if there are any young women out there who are listening to us, who are poets or storytellers or artists or who are aspiring to be so, to become one day, I do respect their struggle so much because there's a lot of sexism and misogyny that women have to face. And I'm afraid it got worse all across the world. So there is a backlash against women's rights and minority rights that we need to be aware of.